how much pressure is there on making a prequel at Pixar? I'm guessing there's a lot.
Yeah,
it was the first time that we've done one, and they're hard.
They're tough because you presumably know the ending, or right. certainly think you do. And so you have to think about them differently. You have to tell a story where knowing the ending at the beginning of the movie is a good thing and is something you need to develop the story. So it sort of changes the way you look at things. And I think a good prequel hopefully makes you feel better about its other film and the characters in the film. So it's really challenging. All movies are challenging, but a prequel is a whole other animal.
And there's a double whammy, of course, because a Pixar movie is a movie that gets watched over and over and over and over and over again. Was there a time in the editing booth where you were just going, I don't know, is that good enough?
Yeah.
Is that going to survive 40 watchings?
Sure, sure. Well, I think every movie has that. Yeah. And luckily, we've watched it 1,000 times or more, and we still like watching it. You know, that's a good test. But
it is tough. Sometimes we have to pull back because sometimes some of the gags or jokes, we do lose sight of what's funny after seeing it for a while. And so we pull back and get other eyes on it. And just to make sure it's like, this is still funny. Because we don't, you know, joke's been in here for 3 years and we're not quite sure if it's still funny.
Yeah, we'll be watching it and someone in the back will laugh. Like, what are they laughing at? Oh, right. This used to be a joke.
I remember jokes.
Yeah.
Exactly. I'm curious about looking at Monsters, Inc. Was it a case of you guys, when you took on this challenge, going, well, let's watch this over and over and over and with a pen and paper to make sure you didn't get anything wrong?
Yeah. We definitely watched it early on. And then I had it on my phone, and I would watch it all the time on the bus to work. Right. Just every now and then, just check in with it.
Yeah.
I mean, we really became sort of students of Monsters,
Inc.
Do you have a favorite incidental character? Because the funny thing is about a prequel is that you're making an incidental character knowing that they're not necessarily going to be back.
Yeah, right. I know, it's true.
So if you put too much emotion into that, you go, it's my baby.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, I think the entire Uzma Kappa team were like our babies.
Yeah.
We loved them. And they're almost designed to be like Mike and Sully's babies. They're, you know, Mike and Sully are best when they're taking care of someone. They're these bickering parents to these sort of sweet, naive little kids.
And I'm curious, you know, this is obviously the second time that the likes of John Goodman and Billy Crystal have been back in the audio booth.
Right.
Is there a continuing problem of ad-libbing where you go, yeah, that's great, but these are the lines?
I love some ad-libbing. I mean, obviously we've crafted the story and we have to stay on story. But within those perimeters, I love to have actors ad-lib, especially those guys.
Yeah.
That said, certainly there's lots of times it's like, that is hilarious and totally inappropriate for a children's film and has nothing to do with the story. But I love it. I mean, I love the energy.
Yeah, you kind of
we take those back to the crew and just let the crew watch them.
Has there been a thing with ADR where, you know, again with the prequel thing, where you go halfway through and went, we need to redo that bit?
Have you had to
top it up in any way? Or has this been one of those Pixar projects where A, B, knew everything?
Nope. We certainly didn't know everything.
No.
But that said, we were pretty lucky. I think by the very end, when we were tightening things up, we didn't have any kind of last minute fixes.
We kind of, you know, we leave one session to the end for all the characters so that we know we try to catch everything at the end, anything that we've missed or anything that we've changed.
And may I congratulate you on your casting? Mm. You pulled it out of the bag. Like, when someone said Nathan Fillion, I went, I know who he's playing and it's going to be brilliant.
Right.
I kind of got it.
Right.
Who came up with the ideas of who you picked, basically?
We sat in a room.
We have great casting directors who have great suggestions, and we try to not look at the actor, you know what I mean, when we even look at their name.
Yeah.
We just look at the character and we hear clips, because we don't want to be, you don't want to be
influenced.
Seduced of, ooh, I'd like to meet that person.
Right.
and you just want to see, does their voice fit that character? Mm-hmm.
So we look at an image of the character and then listen to the clip kind of blind. Mm. So we don't know. So we just really are focusing on which voice fits with that character.
And is it ever the case where you get somebody on board and you go, you are so good at this role, you inhabit it so much, we're going to tweak the design of the character so there's a certain essence of Mirren. Does that ever happen?
No,
not really. Not on this film, anyway. I don't think it happens
very often.
They're
all designed well before we record them.
That said, though, I think what you might be feeling is the animator's contribution. The animator will sometimes I mean, they make all their decisions based on, you know, they just imagine them.
Yeah.
But sometimes an animator will also look at reference of the actor's performance, and I think that sometimes they get a little bit of their facial quality, the way they move their mouth. They want it to kind of match, and sometimes that makes it feel and look like the character.
That's true.
And of course, everyone on Earth has been asking you this, but how much of your own alma mater have you snuck into this? Are there any references to, you know, your bygone days of running around a quad?
Not really.
Not a whole lot.
Well, we
yeah.
weren't probably as crazy and wild in school. Although I do feel like, you know, I was certainly more of a Mike, working very hard, that type of thing. And I think we both felt when we got to college the pressure that Mike feels. The, oh my gosh, I'm not as good as I thought.
Right.
That was very real to both of our college experiences.